This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. An international auxiliary language, sometimes abbreviated as IAL or auxlang or interlanguage, is a language meant for communication between people from different nations who do not share a common first language. An auxiliary language is primarily a second language. Languages of dominant societies over the centuries have served as auxiliary languages, sometimes approaching the international level. Latin, Greek, and the Mediterranean lingua franca were used in the past, and Arabic, English, French, Russian, Spanish, and standard Chinese have been used as such in recent times in many parts of the world. However, as these languages are associated with the very dominance, cultural, political, and economic, that made them popular, they are often also met with resistance. For this reason, some have turned to the idea of promoting an artificial or constructed language as a possible solution. The term auxiliary implies that it is intended to be an additional language for the people of the world, rather than to replace their native languages. Often, the term is used to refer to planned or constructed languages proposed specifically to ease international communication, such as Esperanto, Ido, and Interlingua. However, it can also refer to the concept of such a language being determined by international consensus, including even a standardized natural language, e.g., International English, and has also been connected to the project of constructing a universal language. Contents 1 History 11 Natural International Languages, Lingua Francas 12 Constructing Languages 13 Volepic 14 From Kadam Bevunetic Volapuka to Academia Pro Interlingua 15 Esperanto 16 Ido and the Esperantidos 17 Occidental Interling and Novial 18 Interlingua 19 Internet Age 110 Zonal Constructed Languages 2 Scholarly Study 3 Writing Systems 31 Latin Script 4 Classification 41 Comparison of Sample Texts 411 Schematic Languages 412 Naturalistic Languages 5 Methods of Propagation 6 Pictorial Languages 7 Sign Languages 8 Criticism 9 See also 10 References 101 Notes 102 Bibliography 11 External links History The use of an intermediary auxiliary language, also called a working language, bridge language, vehicular language, or unifying language, to make communication possible between people not sharing a first language, in particular when it is a third language. Language, distinct from both mother tongues, may be almost as old as language itself. Certainly they have existed since antiquity. Latin and Greek or Koine Greek were the intermediary language of all areas of the Mediterranean, Akkadian, and then Aramaic, remained the common languages of a large part of Western Asia through several earlier empires. Such natural languages used for communication between people not sharing the same mother tongue are called lingua francas. Natural international languages, lingua francas. Lingua francas have arisen around the globe throughout human history, sometimes for commercial reasons, so-called trade languages, but also for diplomatic and administrative convenience, and as a means of exchanging information between scientists and other scholars of different nationalities. The term originates with one such language, Mediterranean Lingua Franca, a pidgin language used as a trade language in the Mediterranean area from the 11th to the 19th century. Examples of lingua francas remain numerous, and exist on every continent. The most obvious example as of the early 21st century is English. There are many other lingua francas centralized on particular regions, such as Arabic, Chinese, French, Greek, Portuguese, Russian, and Spanish. Constructing languages. Main article, constructed language. Since all natural languages display a number of irregularities in grammar which makes them more difficult to learn, and they are also associated with the national and cultural dominance of the nation that speaks it as its mother tongue, attention began to focus on the idea of creating an artificial or constructed language as a possible solution. The concept of simplifying an existing language to make it an auxiliary language was already in the Encyclopedia of the 18th century, where Joachim Fege de Villeneuve, in the article on Langue, wrote a short proposition of a laconic or regularized grammar of French. Some of the philosophical languages of the 17th-18th centuries could be regarded as proto-auxlangs, as they were intended by their creators to serve as bridges among people of different languages as well as to disambiguate and clarify thought. However, most or all of these languages were, as far as can be told from the surviving publications about them, too incomplete and unfinished to serve as auxlangs or for any other practical purpose, the first fully developed constructed languages we know of, as well as the first constructed languages devised primarily as auxlangs, originated in the 19th century, Solesle by François Soudre 1787-1862, a language based on musical notes, was the first to gain widespread attention although not, apparently, fluent speakers. Volepic main article, Volepic during the 19th century, a bewildering variety of such constructed international auxiliary languages IALs were proposed, so Louis Couturat and Léopold Lowe in Histoire de la langue universelle 1903 reviewed 38 projects. Volepic, first described in an article in 1879 by Johann Martin Schleyer and in book form. The following year, was the first to garner a widespread international speaker community. Three major Volepic conventions were held, in 1884, 1887, and 1889. The last of them used Volepic as its working language. André Chapillaud writes of the third Volepic convention. In August 1889, the third convention was held in Paris. About 200 people from many countries attended, and, unlike in the first two conventions, people spoke only Volepic for the first time in the history of mankind. 16 years before the Boulogne Convention, an international convention spoke an international language. However, not long after, the Volepic speaker community broke up due to various factors, including controversies between Schleyer and other prominent Volepic speakers, and the appearance of newer, easier to learn constructed languages, primarily Esperanto, from Kadem Bevunetic Volapuka to Academia Pro Interlingua, answering the needs of the first successful artificial language community. The Volapukists established the regulatory body of their language, under the name International Volepic Academy Kadem Bevunetic Volapuka, at the Second Volepic Congress in Munich in August 1887. The academy was set up to conserve and perfect the auxiliary language Volepic, but soon conflicts arose between conservative Volapukists and those who wanted to reform Volepic to make it a more naturalistic language based on the grammar and vocabulary of major world languages. In 1890, Schleyer himself left the original academy and created a new Volepic academy, with the same name, from people completely loyal to him, which continues to this day under Waldemar Rosenberger, who became the director in 1892. The original academy began to make considerable changes in the grammar and vocabulary of Volepic. The vocabulary and the grammatical forms unfamiliar to Western Europeans were completely discarded, so that the changes effectively resulted in the creation of a new language, which was named idiom neutral. The name of the academy was changed to Académie Internationale de Lingue Universelle in 1898, and the circulars of the academy were written in the new language from that year. In 1903, the mathematician Giuseppe Peano published his completely new approach to language construction, inspired by the idea of philosopher Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz. Instead of inventing schematic structures and a priori language, he chose to simplify an existing and once widely used international language, Latin. This simplified Latin, devoid of inflections and declensions, was named interlingua by Peano, but is usually referred to as Latino sine flexione. Impressed by Peano's interlingua, the Académie Internationale de Lingue Universelle effectively chose to abandon idiom neutral in favor of Peano's interlingua in 1908, and it elected Peano as its director. The name of the group then was changed to Academia Pro Interlingua, where interlingua stands for Peano's language. The Academia Pro Interlingua survived until about 1939. It was partly Peano's interlingua that inspired the better-known interlingua presented in 1951. By the International Auxiliary Language Association IALA. Esperanto main article, History of Esperanto after the emergence of Volepic. A wide variety of other auxiliary languages were devised and proposed in the 1880s to 1900s, but none except Esperanto gathered a significant speaker community. Esperanto was developed from about 1878 to 1887, and finally published in 1887, by L. L. Zamenhof, as a primarily schematic language with word stems randomly borrowed from Romance, West Germanic, and Slavic languages. The key to the relative success of Esperanto was probably the highly productive and elastic system of derivational word formation, which allowed speakers to derive hundreds of other words by learning one word root. Also, from early on, Esperantists created their own culture, philosophy, and spirituality, which made them a movement devoted to the sacred cause. See Finvenkismo. Within a few years, this language had thousands of fluent speakers, primarily in Eastern Europe. In 1905, its first first World Convention was held in Boulogne-sur-Mer. Since then, World Congresses have been held in different countries every year, except during the two world wars. Esperanto has become the most outlandishly successful invented language ever and the most widely spoken constructed international auxiliary language. Esperanto suffered a setback after the 1922 proposal by Iran and several other countries in the League of Nations to have Esperanto taught in member nations' schools failed, and Esperanto speakers were subject to persecution under Hitler's and Stalin's regimes, but in spite of these factors more people continued to learn Esperanto, and significant literary work, both poetry and novels, began to appear in Esperanto in the period between the World Wars. Esperanto is still spoken today and has multiple generations of native speakers, although primarily acts as a second language from among the various constructed language projects. It is Esperanto that has so far come closest to becoming an officially recognized international auxiliary language. Edo and the Esperantido's main article, Edo Language: The Delegation for the Adoption of an International Auxiliary Language, was founded in 1900 by Louis Couturat and others. It tried to get the International Association of Academies to take up the question of an international auxiliary language, study the existing ones and pick one or design a new one. However, the Meta Academy declining to do so, the delegation decided to do the job itself. Among Esperanto speakers, there was a general impression that the delegation would of course choose Esperanto, as it was the only auxlang with a sizable speaker community at the time. It was felt as a betrayal by many Esperanto speakers when in 1907 the delegation came up with its own reformed version of Esperanto. Edo drew a significant number of speakers away from Esperanto in the short term, but in the longer term most of these either returned to Esperanto or moved on to other new auxlangs besides Edo. A great number of simplified Esperantos, called Esperantidos, emerged as concurrent language projects. Still, Edo remains today one of the three most widely spoken auxlangs: Occidental Interlang and Novial Main Article. Occidental language. Edgar von Wall's Occidental, also called Interlang, of 1922 was in reaction against the perceived artificiality of some earlier auxlangs, particularly Esperanto, inspired by Idiom Neutral and Peano's Interlingua. Von Wall created a language whose words, including compound words, would have a high degree of recognizability for those who already know a Romance language. However, this design criterion was in conflict with the ease of coining new compound or derived words on the fly while speaking. Occidental gained a small speaker community in the 1920s and 1930s, and supported several publications, but had almost entirely died out by the 1980s. More recently, Occidental has been revived on the Internet in 1928. Edo's major intellectual supporter, the Danish linguist Otto Jespersen, abandoned Edo, and published his own planned language, Novial. It was mostly inspired by Idiom Neutral and Occidental, yet it attempted a derivational formalism and schematism sought by Esperanto and Edo. The notability of its creator helped the growth of this auxiliary language, but soon both Novial and Occidental were abandoned in favor of Interlingua, the first auxiliary language based fully on scientific methodology. Interlingua main article, History of Interlingua. The International Auxiliary Language Association, IALA, was founded in 1924 by Alice Vanderbilt Morris. Like the earlier delegation for the adoption of an international auxiliary language, its mission was to study language problems and the existing auxlangs and proposals for auxlangs, and to negotiate some consensus between the supporters of various auxlangs. However, like the delegation, it finally decided to create its own auxlang. Interlingua, published in 1951, was primarily the work of Alexander Goad, though he built on preliminary work by earlier IALA linguists including André Martinet, and relied on elements from previous naturalistic auxlang projects, like Peano's Interlingua Latino Sign Flexione, Jespersen's Novial, von Wall's Occidental Interlang, and the Academy's Idiom Neutral. Like Occidental, Interlingua was designed to have words recognizable at sight by those who already know a Romance language or a language like English with much vocabulary borrowed from Romance languages. To attain this end, the IALA accepted a degree of grammatical and orthographic complexity considerably greater than in Esperanto or Occidental, though still less than in any natural language. The theory underlying Interlingua posits an international vocabulary, a large number of words and affixes that are present in a wide range of languages. This already existing international vocabulary was shaped by social forces, science and technology, to all corners of the world. The goal of the International Auxiliary Language Association was to accept into Interlingua every widely international word in whatever languages it occurred. They conducted studies to identify the most generally international vocabulary possible, while still maintaining the unity of the language. This scientific approach of generating a language from selected source languages called control languages resulted in a vocabulary and grammar that we can call the highest common factor of each major European language. Interlingua gained a significant speaker community, perhaps roughly the same size as that of Edo, considerably less than the size of Esperanto. Interlingua's success can be explained by the fact that it is the most widely understood international auxiliary language by virtue of its naturalistic as opposed to schematic grammar and vocabulary, allowing those familiar with a Romance language, and educated speakers of English, to read and understand it without prior study. Interlingua has some active speakers currently on all continents, and the language is propagated by the Union Mundial Pro Interlingua UMI, and Interlingua is presented on CDs, radio, and television. After the creation of Interlingua, there were no more successful attempts in international language engineering that would attract a significant number of supporters. Thus, the enthusiasm about constructed languages gradually decreased in the years between 1960 to 1990. Internet age. All of the auxlangs with a surviving speaker community seem to have benefited from the advent of the Internet. Esperanto more than most. The Conlang mailing list was founded in 1991. In its early years, discussion focused on international auxiliary languages as people interested in artistic languages and engineered languages grew to be the majority of the list members, and flame wars between proponents of particular auxlangs irritated these members. A separate auxlang mailing list was created, which has been the primary venue for discussion of auxlangs since then. Besides giving the existing auxlangs with speaker communities a chance to interact rapidly online as well as slowly through postal mail or more rarely in personal meetings, the internet has also made it easier to publicize new auxlang projects, and a handful of these have gained a small speaker community, including Katava, Lingua Franca Nova and Toki Pona. Zonal Constructed Languages. Main article, Zonal Constructed Language. Not every international auxiliary language is necessarily intended to be used on a global scale. A special subgroup are languages created to facilitate communication between speakers of a certain group of related languages. The oldest known example is a Pan-Slavic language written in 1665 by the Croatian priest Juraj Križanić. He named this language Ruski Russian, but in reality it was a mixture of the Russian edition of Church Slavonic, his own southern Chakavian dialect of Serbo-Croatian, and, to a lesser degree, Polish. Most zonal constructed languages were created during the period of Romantic nationalism at the end of the 19th century. Some were created later. Particularly numerous are the Pan-Slavic languages. However, similar efforts have been made at creating umbrella languages for other languages families as well. Teutonish 1902 and Volksprache 1995 for the Germanic languages, Romanid 1956 for the Romance languages, and Afrihili 1973 for the African continent. Nowadays, most older zonal constructed languages are known only to specialists. Most notable among modern examples is Interslavic, a project established in 2011 after the merger of several other projects in 2012. It was reported to have several hundred users. Scholarly study. This section needs expansion. You can help by adding to it. January 2015. In the early 1900s, auxlangs were already becoming a subject of academic study. Louis Couturat et al. Described the controversy in the preface to their book International Language and Science, the question of a so-called world language, or better expressed, an international auxiliary language, was during the now past Volapük period, and is still in the present Esperanto movement, so much in the hands of utopians, fanatics and enthusiasts, that it is difficult to form an unbiased opinion concerning it, although a good idea lies at its basis. 1910, P. V. Leopold Foundler wrote that an IAL was needed for more effective communication among scientists. All who are occupied with the reading or writing of scientific literature have assuredly very often felt the want of a common scientific language, and regretted the great loss of time and trouble caused by the multiplicity of languages employed in scientific literature. For Couturat et al., Volapukists and Esperantists confounded the linguistic aspect of the question with many side issues, and they considered this a main reason why discussion about the idea of an international auxiliary language has appeared unpractical. Some contemporaries of Couturat, notably Edward Sapper, saw the challenge of an auxiliary language not so much as that of identifying a particular linguistic answer of grammar and vocabulary to pressing pragmatic problems of of communication, but rather as one of promoting the principle of a linguistic platform for lasting international understanding, though scholarly interest waned greatly throughout the 20th century. Such differences of approach persist today. Some scholars and interested laymen make concrete language proposals by contrast. Pei and others place the broader societal issue first, yet others argue in favor of a particular language while seeking to establish its social integration. Writing systems, several IAL use the Latin script, some of them like LFN also offer an alternative in the Cyrillic script. Latin script, several IAL use the Latin script. Several sounds, e.g., n, per meter, t, f, are written with the same letter as in IPA. Some consonant sounds found in several Latin script IAL alphabets are not represented by an ISO 646 letter in IPA. 3 have a single letter in IPA. 1 has a widespread alternative taken from ISO 646, UO283, IPA 134, UO292, IPA 135, UO261, IPA 110, single story G equals GUO067, double story G4 are affricates, each represented in IPA by two letters and a combining marker. They are often written decomposed, T, S, equals, T, S, T, equals T. Note, Polish distinguishes between them, D, Z, equals, D, Z. D, equals, D, that means, two sounds, that are one character in IPA and are not ISO 646, also have no common alternative in ISO 646. ISO 639-3 code alphabet name non-ISO 646 letters diacritics multigraph sound, which in IPA is described by ISO 646 letters, is described by different letters sound, which in IPA is described by non-ISO 646 letters, is described by different letters LFN lingua franca nova no yes C, K, yes J, X, RMV Romanova no yes C, K, yes J, Ina interlingua no yes ku, k w, or, k, yes c, k, no ido ido no. Yes ch, t, ku, k w, shish, yes c, t s, q, k, by per kilo second, or, z, yes j, shish, November novial no yes ch, t, shish, y, j, yes q, k, by per kilo second, yes j, shish, IGS interglossa no yes ph, th, ch, rh. Esperanto no yes c, g, h, j, s, u no yes c, t s, no, Mundolinko no yes c, k, no, glosa no yes sc. Yes q, k w, by per kilo second, yes c, t, sc, sambasa no yes c, h, t, shish, and more yes y, as a semi-woval, j, by per kilo second, g z, and more yes j, c h t, shish, shish, c, and more, idiom neutral no yes shish, yes y, j, yes c, t, j, shish, lingua de planeta. No yes c h t, shish, yes x, g s, z, d z, yes c in c h t, j, d, interslavic no yes c, t, n, n j tilde n tilde, s, z, D's, but similar to or same as D Z yes C T S Y I tilde tilde yes C T S Z Europe yes no. Yes C classification. The following classification of auxiliary languages was developed by Pierre Janton in 1993. A priori languages are characterized by largely artificial morphemes not borrowed from natural languages, schematic derivation, simple phonology, grammar and morphology. Some a priori languages are called philosophical languages, referring to their basis in philosophical ideas about thought and language. These include some of the earliest efforts at auxiliary language in the 17th century. Some more specific subcategories, oligosynthetic or oligoisolating languages have no more than a few hundred morphemes. Most of their vocabulary is made of compound words or set phrases formed from these morphemes. Sona and Toki Pona are well-known examples, although Toki Pona's word stock is mostly based on other languages and therefore not a priori taxonomic. Languages form their words using a taxonomic hierarchy, with each phoneme of a word helping specify its position in a semantic hierarchy of some kind. For example, Solezal and RO pisigraphies are purely written languages without a spoken form, or with a spoken form left at the discretion of the reader. Many of the 17th-18th century philosophical languages and Auxlangs were pisigraphies. This set historically tends to overlap with taxonomic languages, though there is no inherent reason a pisigraphy needs to be taxonomic. Logical languages such as Lojban and its predecessor, Loglan, aim to eliminate ambiguity. Both these examples, it should be noted, derive their morphemes from a broad range of natural languages using statistical methods. A posteriori languages are based on existing natural languages. Nearly all the auxiliary languages with fluent speakers are in this category. Most of the posteriori auxiliary languages borrow their vocabulary primarily or solely from European languages, and base their grammar more or less on European models. Sometimes these European-based languages are referred to as Euroclones, although this term has negative connotations and is not used in the academic literature. Interlingua was drawn originally from international scientific vocabulary, in turn based primarily on Greek and Latin roots. Glossa did likewise, with a stronger dependence of Greek roots. Although a posteriori languages have been based on most of the families of European languages, the most successful of these, notably Esperanto, Edo and Interlingua, have been based largely on Romance elements. Schematic or mixed languages have some a priori qualities. Some have ethnic morphemes but alter them significantly to fit a simplified phonotactic pattern, e.g., Volepic, Toki Pona, or both artificial and natural morphemes, e.g., Puryo. Partly schematic languages have partly schematic and partly naturalistic derivation, e.g. Esperanto and Edo. Natural morphemes of languages in this group are rarely altered greatly from their source language form, but compound and derived words are generally not recognizable at sight by people familiar with the source languages. Naturalistic languages resemble existing natural languages. For example, Occidental, Interlingua, and Lingua Franca Nova were developed so that not only the root words but their compounds and derivations will often be recognizable immediately by large numbers of people. Some naturalistic languages do have a limited number of artificial morphemes or invented grammatical devices, e.g. Novial. Note that the term naturalistic as used in auxiliary language scholarship does not mean the same thing as the homophonous term used in describing artistic languages. Simplified natural languages reduce the full extent of vocabulary and partially regularize the grammar of a natural language, e.g. Basic English, Special English and Globish. Citation needed. Comparison of sample texts. Some examples of the best-known international auxiliary languages are shown below for comparative purposes as a reference for comparison. You can find the English and Latin versions of the Lord's Prayer, a text which is regularly used for linguistic comparisons, here. The Lord's Prayer in English, KJV. The Lord's Prayer in Latin, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth, as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Pater Noster, qui es in caelis, sanctificetur nomen tuum, adveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in caelo, et in terra. Panem nostrum quotidianum da nobis hodi, et dimit nobis debita nostra, sicut et nos dimitimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentationem, sed libera nos a malo. Amen. Schematic languages. Volepic version, Esperanto version, Edo version, idiom neutral version, Ofat obas, kel banal in sols, pisaludamos nemola. Komomod monergan ola. Genemas vil olic, as in sul, isu tal. Body absic vataliki givalis obs adello. E partilis obs debis obsic. As id obs I partibs debilis obas e no obis nindicolos in tentati, sod idolivalis obis de bad genosod. Patro nia, quio estas en la cielo, via nomo estu sanctigita venu via regno, plenamigu via volo, quil en la cielo, til ancau sur la terra nien panon sedigan danu al ni hodiau chi pardonu al ni niajn soldogen, quil ancau ni pardonas al niaj soldantoi chi ne conducu nin en tenton, sed liberigu nin de la malbono. Amen. Patro nia, qua eses en la cielo, tua nomo santigis a, tua regno advenis. Tua volo faces quale en la cielo, tail anca sur la terra donas a ni cadi lomnidiala pano, e pardones a ni nia offensi, quale anca ni pardones a nia offensanti, e ne ducte ni aiden latento, ma liberiges ni del malajo. Amen. Nostr patr kel s in cieli. Kvotr nam es sanctificat, kvotr regnia veni, kvotr volu es fazid, quale in seal, tail et su ter dona sidierna noi nostr pan omnidiernic, e pardona a noi nostr debti, quale et noi pardona nostr detitori, e no induca noi in tentation, ma librifica noi da et mal. Amen. Naturalistic languages: Latino sign flexione version, Occidental version, Novial version, Interlingua version, Patra Nostro, qui es in celos, que tuo nomini fi sanctificato, que tuo regno adveni, que tuo voluntate es facto sicut in cielo et in terra da hodi ad nos nostro pain quotidiano, et remit ad nos nostro debitos, sicut et nos remit ad nostro debitors et non induce nos in temptation, sed libera nos ab malo. Amen. Patra nor, qui es in li cieles, me tui nomini esser sanctificae, me tui regnia venir, me tui vol esser fat, qualmen in li cieles talmen anc sur li terra da nos hodi nor pan omnidial, e pardona nor debites, qualmen anc noi pardona nor debitors e ne induct nos in temptation, ma libera nos de lu mal. Amen. Nusen patra, quel es in ciel, me vun nom bli sanctifica, me vun regno veni, me on favun vol KOM in seal Anca sur terre dona nus dissidi li omnidiali pain. E pardona a nus nusen offensos, KOM Anca nus pardona a nusen offensantes, e non ducte nus en tentation, ma liberisa nus fro malu. Amen. Patra nostre, qui es in la celos, k tu nomini sia sanctificate, k tu regno veni, k tu voluntate sia facite como in la cielo, etiam super la terra da nos hodi nostre pan quotidian, e pardona a nos nostre debitos como etiam nos los pardona a nostre debitors e non induce nos in temptation, sed libera nos del mal. Amen. Methods of propagation: as has been pointed out, the issue of an international language is not so much which, but how several approaches exist toward the eventual full expansion and consolidation of an international auxiliary language. Laissez-faire: this approach is taken in the belief that one language will eventually and inevitably win out as a world auxiliary language, e.g. international English, without any need for specific action, institutional sponsorship and grassroots promotion of language programs. This approach has taken various forms, depending on the language and language type, ranging from government promotion of a particular language to one-on-one encouragement to learn the language to instructional or marketing programs. National legislation: this approach seeks to have individual countries or even localities progressively endorse a given language as an official language or to promote the concept of international legislation. International legislation: this approach involves promotion of the future holding of a binding international convention, perhaps to be under the auspices of such international organizations as the United Nations or Inter-Parliamentary Union, to formally agree upon an official international auxiliary language which would then be taught in all schools around the world. Beginning at the primary level, this approach, an official principle of the Baha'i faith, seeks to put a combination of international opinion, linguistic expertise, and law behind a to be selected language and thus expand or consolidate it as a full official world language, to be used in addition to local languages. This approach could either give more credibility to a natural language already serving this purpose to a certain degree, e.g. if English were chosen, or to give a greatly enhanced chance for a constructed language to take root for constructed languages. Particularly, this approach has been seen by various individuals in the IAL movement as holding the most promise of ensuring that promotion of studies in the language would not be met with skepticism at its practicality by its would-be learners. Pictorial languages: there have been a number of proposals for using pictures, ideograms, diagrams, and other pictorial representations for international communications. Examples range from the original Characteristica Universalis proposed by the philosopher Leibniz, to suggestions for the adoption of Chinese writing, to recent inventions such as Blissymbol within the scientific community. There is already considerable agreement in the form of the schematics used to represent electronic circuits, chemical symbols, mathematical symbols, and the energy systems language of systems ecology. We can also see the international efforts at regularizing symbols used to regulate traffic, to indicate resources for tourists, and in maps. Some symbols have become nearly universal through their consistent use in computers and on the internet. Sign languages: an international auxiliary sign language has been developed by deaf people who meet regularly at international forums such as sporting events or in political organizations, previously referred to as gestuno but now more commonly known simply as international sign. The language has continued to develop since the first signs were standardized in 1973, and it is now in widespread use. International sign is distinct in many ways ways from spoken IALs, many signs are iconic and signers tend to insert these signs into the grammar of their own sign language, with an emphasis on visually intuitive gestures and mime. A simple sign language called Plains Indian Sign Language was used by indigenous peoples of the Americas. Gestuno is not to be confused with the separate and unrelated sign language Sinuno, which is essentially a signed exact Esperanto. Sinuno is not in any significant use, and is based on the Esperanto community rather than based on the international deaf community. Criticism: there has been considerable criticism of international auxiliary languages, both in terms of individual proposals, types of proposals, and in more general terms criticisms directed against Esperanto and other early auxiliary languages in the late 19th. Century included the idea that different races have sufficiently different speech organs that an international language might work locally in Europe, but hardly worldwide, and the prediction that if adopted, such an auxlang would rapidly break up into local dialects. Advances in linguistics have done away with the first of these, and the limited but significant use of Esperanto, Ido and interlingua on an international scale, without breakup into unintelligible dialects, has shown that either a rapid breakup into dialects shall not happen too soon in the future, or that there is enough constant standardization to reduce the diversity of the language. Subsequently, much criticism has been focused either on the artificiality of these auxlangs, or on the argumentativeness of auxlang proponents and their failure to agree on one auxlang, or even on objective criteria by which to judge auxlangs. However, probably the most common criticism is that a constructed auxlang is unnecessary because natural languages such as English are already in wide use as auxlangs and work well enough for that purpose. One criticism already prevalent in the late 19th century, and still sometimes heard today, is that an international language might hasten the extinction of minority languages. One response has been that, even if this happens, the benefits would outweigh the costs. Another, that proponents of auxlangs, particularly in the Esperanto movement, are generally also proponents of measures to conserve and promote minority languages and cultures. Although referred to as international languages, most of these languages have historically been constructed on the basis of Western European languages. In the late 19th and early 20th centuries, it was common for Volapük and Esperanto, and to some extent Ido, to be criticized for not being Western European enough. Occidental and interlingua were, among other things, responses to this kind of criticism. More recently, all these major auxlangs have been criticized for being too European and not global enough. One response to this criticism has been that doing otherwise in no way makes the language easier for anyone, while drawing away from the sources of much international vocabulary, technical and popular. Another response, primarily from Esperanto speakers, is that the internationality of a language has more to do with the culture of its speakers than with its linguistic properties. Esperanto itself uses individual words from Indo-European languages, but its grammar is much more similar to Chinese and Greek, while being flexible enough in grammar and sentence structure to be able to copy the word order of Japanese, Indonesian and English all about as well as each other, so it's difficult to judge how much of an Indo-European language it even is. The term Euroclone was coined to refer to these languages in contrast to worldlangs with global vocabulary sources. The term is sometimes applied only to self-proclaimed naturalistic auxlangs such as Occidental and Interlingua, sometimes to all auxlangs with primarily European vocabulary sources, regardless of their grammar, including Esperanto and Lingua Franca Nova. The response to this argument was made by Alexander Goad and reiterated by Mario Pei. A vocabulary selected from a broad variety of languages does not make the language any easier for speakers of any one language. Goad's example compares a paragraph in interlingua with a paragraph with words from Chinese, Japanese, Malay, and other non-European languages. The first, he argues, should be understood by those familiar with the Romance languages, and not overly difficult for most English speakers. La so dice, io mi appella sol io S molto brillante io mi leva al est, e quando io mi leva, il s di io rigarda per tu finestra con mi occhiali brillante como la oro, e io te dice quando il s temporia lever te e io te dice, pigro, leva te io non brilla affin che tu resta al letto a dormire, sed che tu legge e che tu te permina. The second, in contrast, should not only be difficult for speakers of European languages, but Malay speakers likely will not understand the Chinese words, Chinese speakers will likely not understand the Japanese words, and Japanese speakers likely will not understand the Malay words. Mata hari yu, wo ti nama mata hari wo tehan brillante wo leva wo est, dan toki wo leva wo, ada hari wo miru per ni ti finestra sama wo ti mata brillante como kin, dan wo yu ni toki ada tempo a lever ni dan wo yu ni, sust, leva ni wo non brilla sam rap ni tamaru atoko anemaru, sed wo brilla sam rap ni leva ni, dan ke ni suru kam, ni yomu, dan ni iruku. An a priori vocabulary such as that of Spokal or Katava, or a vocabulary constructed mathematically, such as that of Loglan or Lojban, would likely be as comprehensible. Goad argues, additionally, that the Western languages are the unofficial languages of international science, medicine, and technology, and therefore an IAL based on them provides the best access to that literature. Nevertheless, it must be said that a more neutral vocabulary, perhaps even an a priori one, would be less offensive to some non-Europeans in the 1990s and early 2000s. Many proposals for auxlangs based on global sources of vocabulary and grammar have been made, but most, like the majority of the European-based auxlangs of earlier decades, remain sketches too incomplete to be speakable, and of the more complete ones, few have gained any speakers. More recently, there has been a trend on the AUXLANG mailing list and on the more recently founded Worldlong mailing list to greater collaboration between various proponents of a more globally based auxlang. See also see list of constructed languages. Languages hashtag auxiliary languages for a list of designed international auxiliary languages. Interlinguistics International Language Review. Language Education.